Hare Krishna Govindru, thank you very much for joining once again for the Monks Podcast today.
My pleasure.
Yes, our last podcast, we discussed many important issues. So I thought I'll quickly summarize and then we'll take the discussion forward from there. That's okay with you.
Yes.
So we were discussing broadly on the topic of protecting Dharma. And two, three main points that struck me were that, you know, that protecting Dharma is not just like one activity that somebody takes up due to some provocation or due to some external event. It has to be more organic. It's not that somebody becomes a Kshatriya, but rather those who have Kshatriya nature take it up. And in other fields also, when we understand who we are and we grow in that dimension, that direction, then naturally we become influential. And then that itself leads to the protection of Dharma. So rather than seeing it as a separate activity, which somebody has to take up, it is in the natural growth of the individual, Dharma will be protected by different people taking up their roles. Another point which you also made was that we need to, rather than think of when we want to educate and cultivate, it is more that spiritual, there has to be some basic education of Dharma, law and order, social values, but the bhakti education, in terms of the spiritual education, that can be separate. So the idea of secularism, which is in the Vedic tradition, is more intrinsic in the sense that the king's duty is to maintain law and order, dharma, and then one's bhakti is a personal activity which the head of the state does. Head of state, basically, they don't promote anything, but they don't impose anything either. So it's more of they facilitate, they encourage. Whereas in the modern sense, secularism is more a reaction to religious overreach. And so I thought we could, in one sense, differentiate between a secular government and secularism as a worldview. So secularization of the entire world leads to materialism and leads to, it becomes anti-spiritual. But the government being secular in the sense, that is quite compatible with the Vedic tradition. And then we also discussed about in today's world is for protecting Dharma, we can focus more on understanding ourselves and growing internally through self-understanding. And that's the best way we can, in a holistic way, in a sustainable way, practice the help in protecting and expanding Dharma.
Yes.
So that was a quick summary. So I would like to ask two, three questions related with this. Maybe we could go a little backward and in one sense, how was Dharma, say, protected in India and how did it get so, there's a historical direction which we could go. Okay, that there's something we can learn from the history of India, how Dharmic values got lost. That's one direction. You can decide which direction you would like to explore. Another direction is that, say, today there is already some amount of secularization. So if we say that the educational system, say that it shouldn't be teaching, we can have spiritual values being taught separate from the educational system. So to create that structure, that itself is going to take a significant amount of time. And will that structure be able to compete with the mainstream educational structure and its values? Even the mainstream academia, it teaches religion, but teaches in a quite a different way, which will not necessarily be fostering spiritual values. So that educational direction, how could we create an educational infrastructure that is effective? That's one direction we could take. And another direction could be that, say, in today's world, when there are, when in general, the word dharma has become highly, not necessarily dharma, but there is always any kind of activism is immediately labeled as fanaticism. That say Hinduism and any kind of Hinduism is labeled as Hindutva. And then Hindutva is considered right wing and then it is condemned. So how can we be assertive without being, without coming off as fanatical, without getting into that negative branding and then defending ourselves? And so these are broadly three directions, the educational direction, the historical direction, and you could say somewhat the political direction. If you get time, we can go through all three, but which one would you like to address, any particular one?
I think it is integrated. They are interconnected only.
Okay, right.
You know, yeah, they're very interconnected. And please. Therefore, we will basically intertwine it, depending upon sometime we might emphasize one over other, but not necessarily neglect the other two principles also. Yeah.
Yes, true. So if you consider from let's begin with the historical perspective. See, one reason I thought of is recently I've been reading a little bit about world history, and in many ways, India is the only, I'm using the word India, we can use the word Bharat or whatever word you want to use, but it is the only place where the ancient culture, we have many civilizations from the Mesopotamian civilization, Iranian civilization, Egyptian civilization, but it is practically the only country where the ancient civilization is still prevalent. Of course, there are changes, but there is still an undeniable continuity. But if you go to modern Egypt, there is practically nothing of the Egyptian civilization left. Now, to some extent, China as a country is there. But if you consider many of the Chinese thinkers, they don't have that much influence in shaping individual Chinese lives as, say, China is now, it had a history of communism. Now it is a communist capitalist hybrid. We don't want to go into that. But my point is that while India had been invaded repeatedly by many invaders, but still Dharma had a resilience. And then even though we could say that the westernization is happening, but in many ways, as westernization is happening, still I feel there is some amount of, we could say, rejuvenation. Like Indians in the West, many of them, especially after they start having children, they want to learn what is our culture, what are our values, and how can we promote them. I was reading one book on Indian history. So it seems in post-independence India, from the last 70 years, like Hindus have built more temples than in the past 300 years. So in some ways, it's not just like some people say that the materialism has come up and westernization has come up and things are becoming lost because of that. So even through that, there is some amount of staying power. So the two things, one is what is the reason for having the staying power? And of course, we also know that there was a lot of aggression and a lot of damage also happened because of overt or covert aggression. So maybe you could speak something about this.
Yeah, this is a very interesting and very important point what you mentioned, you know, by giving this example of building temples and how Dharma continued to prevail compared to other civilization, Chinese, Western, or South American also.
Yes.
Right. So therefore, I remember, you know, hearing from one very nice, wise, intelligent person. He said, when Dharma is attacked, we should understand it is not that Dharma is being attacked. It is one aspect of Dharma is being attacked, whether it is social fabric, political fabric, or educational fabric.
Okay.
So he said, our response should not be panicky. We should be alert, but should not be panicky.
Okay.
And other responses are, Dharma is eternal, nothing will happen. That is laziness. Right? Indifference caused by Dharma is eternal is tamoguna. And aggression, reactive behavior caused by one aspect of Dharma being attacked is a sign of rajo flavored with tamo.
Yes. That is labeled.
No? So therefore, when we see that the definition of Dharma is not given by a group of people or a community or a society. So therefore, there is no question of fighting for protecting it, because Dharma is naturally existing everywhere. I don't protect Dharma. I protect myself, realigning myself with Dharma.
Let me clarify what you're trying to say is that, so rather than thinking of Dharma in terms of, say, external structures like temples, or that we have to protect Dharma means people think about that, but that our scripture should not be misinterpreted, or our external temple should not be desecrated. So while that is one aspect of it, but you're saying at a more fundamental level, Dharma is lost when we ourselves become lost, when we are not aligned with ourselves properly.
And those who are attacking the extended principle of that dharma are basically none other than people who were part of dharmic values only, by whatever they name call themselves, whether it is pagan religion in Arabic world or the European world or in the African world, right? Mm. So when they start realizing, and therefore the dharma civilization, the duty of dharma civilization, more than anything else, is continuously debating on this concept, including from our own self to our family, our village, our community, you know. So when that is done properly, systematically, just imagine in the Bhagavatam there is a story of Hiranyakashipu tormenting. Now who could stop? Where is Aurangzeb compared to Hiranyakashipu? Where is Aurangzeb compared to Kamsa? Right, and this was happening in Satya Yuga. Very conscious destruction of anything which is connected to dharma, Vedas, Shraddha. You know, you could not even think of God in your own heart. They couldn't think of the Lord also. That also you could figure out. Hey, they're thinking, catch them and kill them.
Thought police, huh? Like that in today's world we have. Okay.
No. And then his very son, was born in his very family, he destroyed his very fabric. Therefore, if you remember last talk we were discussing, the critical thinking against Islam and Christianity has to come from Islam and Christianity only.
Yes.
The positive critical thinking. Right. And for Sanatan Dharma, you know, we need to have a lot of more positive thinking, because with Sanatan Dharma, everybody, like I remember somebody saying that when it comes to Sanatan Dharma, people say the dharma itself is wrong. There is a problem in Bharat, and Bharat is a problematic. Me bahut bada antar hai. You know, the many so-called intellectual amongst the Hindu community, those who are atheist, those who are agnostic, or those who are, those who are from the background of reason and logic, while they condemn everything about Sanatana Dharma in regards to Western civilization, in regards to Abrahamic faith, you know, you don't have to slander. At least understand it as it is.
So you are contrasting that with that even in Abrahamic traditions, if there is some extremism, that has to be reformed from within.
Yes. But
in our tradition, instead of reforming from within, there is almost like a wholesale condemnation by some people.
Yeah, as a simple example, when you speak about Islamic aggression, they would say, oh, there is no terrorism as no religion. But when it comes to Brahminical, whatever happened, you know, 400, 300 years ago, they will hold them responsible, not only one or two people, the entire community, as if they are such a violent, aggressive, terrorist people. You know, you can see that so visibly seen all the time.
That is so true. I was once reading an article in The Guardian. It was about how many Europeans had joined Islamic States and other extremist organizations. And the whole article's thrust was that actually it is not Islam that is radicalizing people. Rather, there were people already who were deformed and they had a radical mentality, and Islam just became an excuse for them. So now, of course, it's possible that one extreme is there, but to completely say that is like, you know, you want to, it is, you could say, whitewashing one thing. And then, like recently also, when the Bangladesh attacks were there, the news coverage was so slanted. One side they said, yeah, but there was some immediate, far more prominence was given to the fact that after India lost to Pakistan, there some people were arrested in India because they're celebrating the victory of Pakistan.
Yeah. So this bias. So then the question is raised, you know, how come someone can be so shameless and dishonest in regards to journalism? How can they sleep in the night? You know, the demon within their own heart of bias, shamelessness, how will they allow them to sleep? Because it is not possible only. You can be so brutal, dishonest in the name of, you know, in the name of transparent journalism. So these questions are supposed to be raised by everybody. Once we realize, okay, you know, this is the reality, they are not representing the news, they're representing particular agenda based upon being purchased or being completely brainwashed. Right? So therefore, we see that the same people, they will tell others, never forget what you experienced by the Brahmins. And then when it talk about the radical Islamic invasion, they said, no, that will create a disturbance. We should not remember the past. We should move on with the, you know, with the present and future rather than digging out the old stories.
Yes.
So there is, this is a not, it is beyond hypocrisy. You know, it is not even hypocrisy. It is beyond hypocrisy. It is sickening. That's what I said. How can they sleep in the night by being so, so biased and so much adharmic in this regard? So that is called as Rakshasi Vritti. That is not even adharma. That is Rakshasi Vritti.
Okay. So I'm just trying to trace the flow. See, we were discussing about how to protect dharma and how dharma in one sense was it lost because of various aggression. So you're talking about in today's world, it is, if there is attack on dharma, it is, say, on the more in the presentation of dharma in the media, there is a distortion. Are you talking about that attack right now?
Yeah, that is there. Even if that is there, even if that attack is there, but by very nature, dharma, just like during the corona, the prakriti, which was abused, misused, exploited by the human existence, consciously, unconsciously, doesn't matter, but the consequences are the same. Whether you choose to exploit the nature or whether you simply be part of the civilizational reality, still the mother nature was exploited. She bounced back. The prakriti bounced back and she just shunned all the human existence from her surrounding at least for a few months to cleanse herself. Right? So similarly, dharma is synonymous to nature. Now you have the facility to stand for your own dharma. When you stand for your dharma, just like Jatayu, knowing very well that I cannot fight Ravan, I cannot completely defeat, but at least I will fight him to such an extent that I will delay the kidnapping of Mother Sita and conveying the message to Lord Ram according to his own capacity. And that message by Jatayu, the truthful message, you know, that became the foundation of Mother Sita's serf and then attack on Ravana's kingdom. So we cannot underestimate our own contribution, however small and insignificant it is. It can be a vital information, vital contribution from the perspective of the entire, you know, the overall perspective.
Okay.
Right? So therefore, interestingly, dharma never got lost. It is just like when you're in the hospital, when people are in the hospital, you see when they're, when the heart, you know, is pumping, it is going down. What do you call it? That graph? A graph is not flat. Flat means dead.
Okay.
No. It is always going up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. So there is always, forever, the battle between Sura and Asura is an eternal reality.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. And therefore, the Pandavas, the number is very less. but they have the power to dislodge the Kauravas. Shivaji Maharaj in number very less, but he had the courage and power to create a civilization, Maratha Empire. Who would ever imagine the mountain people from the Mawal? They extended their kingdom up until Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat. Gayakwads ruled in Gujarat. You know, Sindhias, they are not none other than Shindes. If you read the civilizational history of Maratha, you know, they are not even considered from the modern historian point of view, very organized community. They are part-time farmers and part-time soldiers.
Mm.
But they created something. And every creation which has, there are something flaws and something good point. Nobody, the beauty of Dharma, Dharma has the courage to find faults with your own people also. Whether it is Bhishma, whether it is Yudhishthir, whether it is Arjuna, Vyasadeva is willing to explain the limitation of their behavior.
Mm-hmm.
No other literature has the courage to critically analyze their own people. Wherein you find, you know, it's okay to kill a dharmic person like, you know, like Duryodhan is being killed. That's very common. The good against the evil. But here, the foundationally good person is taking the side of adharma for some time. Even for that person, there is a concept of justice.
You're talking about somebody like Bhishma?
Yeah, even somebody like Bhishma. So not only we do critical thinking, our Sanatan Dharma is telling, if there is a need, he should be eliminated with kindness. He should be eliminated with tears in your eyes. Where do you find such a thrilling story where a person is killing his grandfather with limitless pain in his heart?
So it's beautiful. So what you're trying, if I try to understand what you're saying, is that there is a emphasis on administering justice, but without succumbing to hatred or animosity. So in one sense, at a social level, the principle of dharma is maintained, but at an individual level, one you could say the relationship is also maintained. There is respect is maintained.
Yeah.
Okay.
You disagree with their decision, but you don't disagree with their relationship with them.
Okay.
You know, Prahlad never wanted his father to go to hell. I remember listening to a debate. You know, some moderator asked a very staunch, very deep Christian student, a practitioner, what happens if your parents don't take to Christianity?
Hmm.
And with great sincerity, she said, I know I love them, but they will experience hell. But here, Prahlad, when he asked Lord Narsingadev, you know, he said, you know, please forgive my father. Lord Narsingadev said, already forgiven.
Huh.
So Lord Narsingadev or Prahlad, they had no problem with Hiranyakashipu as a person. They had a problem with Hiranyakashipu's activities. The punishment was given to his activities, not to him.
So in that sense, the soul, the core person, the soul never becomes stained.
Yes.
And there is, so then there is, that's why there is a dynamism that at one level, Krishna tells Arjuna, Pandita Samadarshina, see everyone equally. But at the same time, Krishna is also telling Arjuna to fight.
Yes.
So, yeah. So at the level of soul, everybody is equal. But then what is the best way to deal with them so that their soul can be elevated gradually?
Yes.
Or they can stop other people's spiritual evolution, spiritual growth, or even social administration. That if they're stopping that, then we have to deal with them differently.
Yes. And therefore, when we present Dharma like this, who will not at the very, you know, conclusion of their life feel, oh, there was something wrong in my understanding of my faith, my religion, and I want to transcend. They may not speak, I guarantee you, anybody having a common sense, in the heart of their heart will question what they're exactly doing about radicalized, blind following of their faith. Doesn't matter which faith it is, because it doesn't make sense into their core. But because they don't know anything but this, they do not have the courage to express it externally. You can imagine what kind of trauma, pain, conflict they would be going through.
They means whom are you referring to here?
They means those who are blinded by faith without dharma.
Oh, okay. So they have a conscience, and
yes,
their faith is making them do something which is against their conscience.
Yes, and that conscience is dharma. That conscience is dharma. No.
Really? Conscience, yeah. Is dharma.
Yeah, and that dharma is judging their faith.
Okay. No. Dharma is judging their faith. That's beautiful. So here, what would you translate that faith as, if in Sanskrit terms? It is more of bhakti or something like that, or shraddha?
Anything which is shraddha, like the Bhagavatam explains, and the Mahabharata also explains, and the Gita explains, like dharma and shraddha, when they are married, that gives rise to auspiciousness, third canto Bhagavatam.
Hmm.
You know, dharma is the foundation for everything. Right.
True.
So then your shraddha is not making you sense internally, but because you are part of a group and you pose your shraddha more aggressively. I remember reading somewhere, who is fanatic? A fanatic is one who doesn't have an internal substance, but externally he is very aggressive about what he does. That is a fanatic.
Beautiful. In one sense, the external aggression is actually an overcompensation for...
It's internal emptiness.
Internal emptiness, yeah.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah.
Of course, I don't know if that is the only category, because there are some people who seem to be totally convinced. Like if you read somebody who wrote the Communist Manifesto, if we read any of those books, these people seem to be completely convinced about their ideologies. So
that is when they wrote it, when it was fresh. Like I was discussing yesterday in our class, that when in the 15th, 16th century, when the scientific community, you know, they met with illogical understanding of creation, the time factor of creation, you know, they became atheistic, Gnostic. Mm. But being Gnostic does not make them feel to question their own existence. They had complete faith in their own existence while questioning the existence of God. So somewhere the Asti was there. Astikta was somewhere evolved. Somewhere it was there, right? Because it is not possible only a living entity at the end of the day. In fact, forget that. Ravana and Duryodhan are considered as, now Ravan, Duryodhan is considered as a personification of Kali. Right?
Okay, yeah.
He's not Papi, but he's Papa. There is a big difference.
Okay.
Papa is different from a person. But here Duryodhan is defined as a personification of Papa.
Okay.
Ravana is a personification of Kama, you know, not the Kama of the four Purusharthas. You know, obsessive attachment. But both Ramayana and Mahabharata give a hint of some transformation experienced by them. Wherein Ravana is thinking, I need to go and touch Mother Sita. After all, she's goddess of fortune. And in Mahabharata, it is more clearly, explicitly explained. Where Ashwatthama is telling Duryodhan, I guarantee you, Duryodhan, on the battlefield of Kurukshetra on the 14th or 15th day, if you withdraw from the battle, the Pandavas will accept you. And Duryodhan thought for the moment. And when he encountered Satyaki on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, he said, what the hell am I doing? What is this all about? You are my such a good friend. The good sense prevailed even in the heart of Duryodhan. Because how can you not reach to your original constitutional reality of knowledge in a bliss and eternality? That will keep haunting everybody. Therefore, the practitioners of Sanatan Dharma, you know, they should never be aggressive in regards to changing people in a systematized way. You just give them profound knowledge and wisdom and let them be disturbed by this wisdom.
Okay, so rather than creating systems for transforming people, we focus on more on creating systems for transmitting knowledge, and then knowledge will itself transform.
Because ultimately, you know, according to Gita, Krishna is saying there is nothing more sublime than knowledge.
Mm.
You know, one who is situated, however accidentally or by any means, one who comes closer to that boat of transcendental knowledge, he will be shaken to the core, he will be shaken to the root.
Mm.
No, they might not change immediately, but at least they know, you know, this is the reality, but I'm stuck to this. So let me follow this one. So you already shook their core, or you have actually brought them to their core. Externally, they may not be able to practice, but internally, they have accepted the reality, but they not have the courage, they may not have the facility, they may not have the resources to completely change from what they are.
Okay. So... so if we go back to the overall flow, what you are saying is today that if we just focus more on presenting the knowledge systematically, that itself will lead to people aligning with who they are, and that is the best way to protect dharma.
Yes.
Okay.
Because the foundation of dharma is shastra. You know, when that foundation of dharma, in regards to disciplining, when it appears, like Shastra and Shastra, Sudarshana. Krishna gives you Sudarshana through his philosophy. And if you don't agree, then reluctantly he gives you Sudarshana Chakra. But the goal is not Sudarshana Chakra, the goal is Sudarshana Shastra.
Sudarshan, that means the Shastra gives us proper vision. Huh?
Yeah, Sudarshan, Darshan,
okay.
Shastra.
Beautiful, okay. Then,
no, auspicious philosophical, you know, darshan, dekho na, it is not synonymous to philosophy. What a word our rishis have used.
Mm.
For tattva, they have called it a darshan shastra.
It's beautiful.
Huh?
So it's rather than telling people don't do this, if you just give them the vision to see how what they are doing is, or which of their choices is beneficial, which is harmful, then naturally they will themselves choose well.
And therefore, why dharma must have, you know, it may have come down, but never crashed completely.
Mm-hmm.
Why the Western civilization, the pagan religion, the South American religion completely got destroyed? Dharma was non-existent there. Dharma was existing there in a folk tradition. But in India, dharma has existed in the folk tradition and also in the classical literature. And because of the classical literature like Mahabharata, Upanishad, Bhagavat, Ramayana, you know, Vedas, therefore, however much attacks happened physically, the core was very strong, it revived back. It would prevail again and again and again and again.
Hmm.
Just see, when did you ever expect about 15, 20 years ago, some of the politicians quoting Mahabharata and Ramayana or going to the temple?
Hmm.
So even if they go externally, superficially, but when you stand in front of something so tangible and so substantial, you know, you'll be questioned. You idiot, you rascal, you're standing here. Do you have a shame?
No. Shame in what sense?
That you cannot...
deny the tangible reality of what
you see. So then you're talking as if you're a secular, you're talking as if you're slandering Sanatan Dharma just to get few votes. The political slander by the political leaders against Sanatan Dharma is purely based upon appeasement politics. Because how can you stand in the presence of Satya? Satya is connected to eternality and agenda is connected to temporariness. The Kauravas represent agenda and Pandavas represent Satya.
That's fascinating. But you could say even the fact that there are different people who come up with different agendas, that is an eternal phenomenon, isn't it? So it's always someone will come up with some agenda.
Yes.
And that will keep diverting people or disrupting the dharma in the world.
Yeah. So therefore, Surasura Yuddha is not only connected to Kali Yuga. Surasura Yuddha, one may say, Kali Yuga is so bad. I don't agree with that. Kali Yuga compared to Satya Yuga is the most, it gives you such a facility to practice. You can believe anything, nobody touches you. You may not speak about it, but you can believe anything. No, you can speak to you privately to anybody. But during Satya Yuga, you could not even feel what you believe. There was a greater control by the demonic forces to the level of your consciousness.
Really, in what sense?
Like Hiranyakashipu could figure out, if you would remember, Krishna, Lord Narayan, he will attack you.
So you're saying that even in Satyuga, there were extremely dark patches.
Yeah.
Other than what were in Kaliyuga also, we might see.
Yeah, and how long Hiranyakashipu lived? Not 100 years. It is not like a Mughal invasion for 200 years. What is 200 years? Compared to Hiranyakashipu controlling for 1,000 years. And because the rishis had this deep understanding of that, and therefore they relentlessly battled against adharma and kept the civilization not only floating, it was prosperous. And the attacks would happen in pockets.
No.
And when that attacks which happen in the pockets, whether it is, the exploitation by one community to or other, these were all not national, organized, centralized exploitation with dharma community also. It was a sporadic, it was a selfish, it was based upon few people selfishly trying to, do something which was against, like we read the Chaitanya Charitamrita, right? So what we read only part is Smartha Brahmanas were, against Mahaprabhu's mission. And who is Mahaprabhu for that matter? He's also Brahmana only. Who is Srivas Thakur? He's also Brahmana. Who is Nityananda? He's a Brahmana. The wrong Brahmanas, we hear their stories. The Smarthas. Now Smartha is not a jati. Smartha Brahmanas it's an amazing story. Sometime we will discuss about, the Brahmanas of India. I want to discuss that topic also.
Oh, okay.
I'm not started, but there is a desire to write a book on atrocities against the Brahmanas.
Against the Brahmanas?
Yeah, atrocities against the Brahman community. And since I'm not a Brahmana, I have all the right to write it. I'm not born a Brahmana, so that I can write about it. So it's very interesting. We focus on the wrongdoings of the Brahmana, but we don't focus on the revolution created by the very Brahmanas.
There are many, even you could say pre-colonial Western pilgrims who have talked about how very positively about the Brahmanas also, how they were like guides and mentors and advisors for society, and they helped them in their times of distress. So there is one who is that for? I forgot that, you know, he says that what all the Brahmanas did in the society extended far more than what any Christian minister would do. I also read some books, pre-colonial Western pilgrims who came to India or Western travelers who came to India. And they said the Brahmanas had a very influential, positive role in society. They were advisors, friends, guides, not just priests, but they had a much bigger role than what priests had in society.
Again, if you just recollect your old school days, you know, at least in our generation, the teachers who taught us came from very nice background, who were good teachers and happened to be Brahmanas. And I studied in a Christian school. Still, the best of the teachers were Brahmins only who were teaching us. And the most difficult subjects, science and maths, would always be taught by the Brahmin teacher.
That's interesting.
And without any discrimination. As I said, I'm not a Brahmana, but they were equal in regards to. So therefore, the experience of one group of people in regards to, because the nature of material world, there is a conflict between selfishness and selflessness, whether it is Duryodhan or anybody else. So when you are selfish, that is the main focus of dharma literatures. You know, when you become so swarthy, then your rakshasi pravritti develops. They do not worry about your faith. Again, we have repeatedly, you know, unfortunately, in the modern world, even dharmic traditions, they focus on your faith. If somebody is not a devotee of Krishna, but is a dharmic person, do we have the right to call him as a rakshasa?
Now, this itself, like, unless a person would find it contradictory, unless the person understands what is dharmic. So dharmic, basically, you're talking more like a little bit sattvic, a person living according to certain values.
And he also believes in Vedic samskaras. It is not that he's Gnostic. You cannot be Gnostic as a dharmic person. One of the components of dharma, therefore, how dharma differs from secularism is, secularism unfortunately actively propagates atheism. And dharma privately encourages you to remain theistic.
Okay. That's nicely put. And but then at one level, we also talked about dharma as conscience.
Yeah.
So now if you talk about dharma as broadly conscience or aligning with oneself, then there could be people across the world who may not be specifically following Vedic sanskaras, but they also would be having some level of dharmic values. So when you're talking about samskaras, you're not necessarily talking about specific rituals, or you're talking more about the principle of
samskaras. The Sanatan Dharma has a very refined way to align with the samskaras through certain rituals. You know, they design certain rituals, they align with the principle of samskaras. So in other pagan religion, they may not have the right kind of rituals, but they had the right kind of understanding of dharma everywhere. Dharma is universal. It doesn't have a name. You know, you don't have to be a follower of Vedic Shastra per se to be a dharmic, but you will have the concept of Vedic Shastra without understanding the Vedas.
That's beautifully put.
You know, when the leaders of the Native Americans, when they were told by the white people to sell their land, I remember reading this letter long back in one of the news articles. He communicated with them in regards to what they consider with their land, with their water, their river. If you read that, you will remember the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita.
True.
So he does not know the verses of Bhagavad Gita, but somewhere he has clicked to the essence of that chapter.
That's true. It's a one of the results of secularism is what there is one this concept of the disenchanted world. The world is completely reduced to mechanical operations and mechanical functions, and the whole element of higher consciousness or higher purpose or higher understanding is eliminated, and then that makes life itself quite barren. And that there was this there was a integrated, or you could say conscious outlook, which is there almost across most you could say pre-modern cultures.
Absolutely, because there is a need for the living entity to experience some kind of miracle beyond predictable mechanistic reality.
Okay.
And therefore, even in the Western world, where Christianity is dominant, capitalism is dominant, atheism is dominant, still the Western astrology is still functioning. You know, people do practice, you know, it may not have a connection to Vedic astrology, but the concept of Jyotish Shastra is there in whatever form.
Jyotish Shastra means specifically the central role that astrology had in today's world. I don't think it has been there in pre-modern Europe, at least from what I've read. But you're talking about the recognizing that there are some higher principles which we have to align with.
Yes.
Okay. And much of that today may be dismissed as superstition, but then we end up living a very barren existence.
And therefore, at the end of the day, they may propose barren existence as a philosophy because they're part of that group. But in their private life, somewhere they will look into Google or something to understand, you know, how it operates.
Yeah, that's why it's so it's like a paradox that there is so much entertainment in today's world, like science fiction and comics books, they all involve supernatural elements. And so many supernatural elements, and people are fascinated by that.
Yes.
So in that sense, you could almost say that the attraction to the supernatural is natural in the human heart.
Because otherwise the human being will be bored with his own limited capacity to understand life. That's boring. You know, if everything is predictable and you are able to figure out and explain, what next, man? It is so boring. Tell something very suspense. Tell something which is beyond it, something which is abstract.
So it's interesting. If you look at European history, science itself started as that. That they had the religious worldview makes nature so staid and barren that it's simply a backdrop for the purpose of deliverance, for liberation, salvation. But we will explore nature now. So science actually started with the attitude of, at least modern science, it started with the attitude of exploring the mystery of nature, the mystery of how things work. But from there, the way science has progressed is that rather than focusing on the mystery, now it is more of removing the mystery and almost denying anything mysterious and reducing everything, reducing the mysterious to the mechanical.
But even amongst them also, there are many people who would not want to, you know, focus on that part, just reducing it to mechanical reality. If Einstein and other such scientists, you will come, they'll say, you're not scientists, you're carpenters.
Carpenters.
There is nothing bad about carpenter. But the point is, carpenter has a structure, he has a shape, he has a size, he has a tape, he makes a chair, you know, very predictable reality. Right? But even amongst the carpenter, if you see certain work, woodwork, somewhere there will be some chamber where you can keep things. Even a carpenter wants to create a mystery in his creation. What to speak of somebody is exploring beyond just woodwork. That is not possible only.
That's true.
Yeah.
So if I try to understand the overall subject, so you are saying that that dharma at one level was present, we could say in a latent form everywhere.
Yes.
So that's the innate nature of people.
Yeah.
And that cannot be destroyed completely. But what can be done is, it may be misunderstood, it may be misrepresented. So if we can, you can explain it properly, then we inspire people to align with it. And that's the best way we can have rejuvenation today.
Yeah, and therefore another interesting part, education. Now, education was never ever the responsibility of the state.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Education was never ever controlled by the state. It was always, always inspired and facilitated by the families, communities. Decentralize, you know, sensitive to whom you are teaching, which surrounding they would live, they would control, and the kings and the royalty would offer not grant, but honor, that I want to, you know, I want to assist in your education system without ever controlling the teachers.
Okay. No? That is very striking. When you said that it is not controlled by the state, I thought you said it was controlled by the Brahmanas. But rather than focusing on Brahmanas, it is more like the commune, the family, the community, according to the what are the needs of society, it was provided.
Yeah. So Brahmanas cannot teach you Vaishya Vritti, na? So education, depending on who you are, it is not that all the teacher always belong to Brahmana. But amongst the whatever community, those who had the Brahmanical qualities of educating people, they would teach. If I want to learn carpentry, not every carpenter can teach you. They can make the woodwork, but they may not be a teacher. So there would be a Brahmana amongst the carpenter who knew how to give that knowledge to others.
That's a very subtle point, a very important. So in one sense, rather than if we take today's professions, we cannot simply categorize that this profession is Brahmanical and this profession is Vaishya. It is a little more complicated than that. Because even within one profession, there could be people with different dispositions.
Naturally, a Brahmana can tell you the philosophy of farming, but he can't teach you farming. Then you have to go to the farmer who has the capacity to teach you. So therefore, who is he? He's a Brahmana when he's teaching, but farmer when he's tilling.
Yeah, this is so fascinating, Guru. This is like opening a whole universe for me. Because especially in the Western world, this is a big issue of turmoil. Recently, there was an election in Virginia where one of the political candidates for the governor, he said that the parents should have no control over what the school is going to teach the students. And basically, in the school, they were teaching all woke ideology, the critical race theory and other things. And many parents agitated against that. And the whole election became an issue of parenting. So
lost the election, huh?
Yeah, he completely lost the election very quite badly. It was a stronghold and he lost it. So the idea that the state should control the education, that is a very easy way to indoctrination.
Yes,
and that's what communists did, isn't it?
Yeah. And therefore, again, dharma prevails to such an extent, you know, the whole concept of, it's so amazing that somebody who did not control anything was the in charge of education, including not controlling the student. The teacher and student dynamic, it is so important to understand the purpose of the teacher while educating the student is not to influence the student to become his chela or to his subordinate. The purpose of education is to free the chela from being obligation to gratitude. Make them stand on their own feet. A teacher guru was not a drug. He was a nectar. And nectar is not a medicine where you take regularly, like for a chronic disease.
Oh, God.
No.
In counseling or self-help, there's one of the principles they say that the best counselor is one who makes oneself redundant.
Yes, and that is how Vedic education worked like that.
So in one sense, we can say that the student, it's not that the student thinks I have learned so much that I don't need to learn anything more, but rather the student gets a eagerness for learning, but doesn't become dependent on someone else.
Yes, he will experience gratitude for throughout his life, but not burden the teacher himself. And neither the teacher will control, hey, what do you know? You don't know anything. You stay here only. If you keep your student ignorant, that is the time you can control. And therefore, you cease to be a teacher.
That brings to another point also that, if the state shouldn't control what is taught, but even like in today's world, the left has in many ways penetrated the academy quite a bit. And then they control what is to be taught. And there are many parents who feel so concerned that, especially in America, and even in India, to some extent it's happening, that not so much, but many parents feel alarmed to especially let their children go to humanities. In the STEM fields, it has not come so much. But even there, it's like the education is to some extent becoming like ideological indoctrination. So that is prevented significantly if there's a decentralized model where people decide based on the needs of the community, needs of the individual, how education should take place.
And even if that is not done, even if the state is not willing to do that, there is a solution for it. Let us focus on state's resources to give skill education to us. Let us focus on the state to exploit the resources in such a way our children learn the skill for their financial independence. But the same parents, along with allowing their children to be controlled by the state in regards to their professional growth, if they don't give education which is connected to Shastra, right? Who can stop that from them doing it? But what our parents do, our parents are more interested in teaching rituals rather than teaching education of Shastra. They will teach them the dependence of God, which is very superficial, rather than teaching the laws of God, because that takes more time. Depend on Krishna is very easy to say, right? But teaching duality to the children, you know, life is dual. There is victory and there is a defeat. There is happiness and there is a distress. There is sometimes you win, sometimes you lose, right? The foundational principle of Gita, if they are taught, and part of that foundational principle is, you know, why Shraddha is required, why faith is required, what does faith do, what is faith means, how do you experience presence of God in your life? If they are systematically taught, because the parents want to hand over the responsibility of their material growth and spiritual growth. One, the modern education, they allow their children to be controlled by the state, and they allow their children to be controlled by a certain institution. And those who fear the control of the institution, they do not teach them anything connected to spirituality. They say, no, if we teach spirituality, that means they'll give up everything and join the system of giving up everything else. Right? And that no state can control. Absolutely nobody can control. And those who have learned assertively their education system, they may drift away from their habits for some time, but they will not drift away from the belief system what they've experienced from their childhood. For example, you know, I will continue to remain follower of Sanatana Dharma as a grown-up student going to a college, but I may try something which is modern, which may not be good for my health, you know, some intoxication, right? Some distraction. But that does not remove their strong belief system. But teaching rituals without logic behind the ritual also go away, and the logic will come how to slander that very ritual which they practice.
Yeah, because in one sense, the logical faculty is still there.
Yeah.
Not trained to be directed to understand it, he'll be trained to sort of reject it or condemn it or criticize it.
Yeah,
that's so true.
Like whenever people, this is, you know, there's nothing about saying boastful, that when we come to spirituality, you know, kind of background we came from, you know, the question of fear of, or you will give up spirituality, you lose faith, I said, doesn't exist. Faith is not taught in the organization. Faith is the core character of our upbringing.
Okay.
You know,
now, this is interesting. At one level, you said first that dharma is a core characteristic. So you're saying faith is also a core characteristic.
That they gave in such a way, it was not institutionalized. Faith was not institutionalized. That was cultural, you know, and slowly because of the good friends and right understanding of political reality, social sensitivity, you know, some kind of cultural this thing, it became ingrained into your system. Therefore, what Prabhupada said, you know, Indians are so close to God and they're distracting because of materialism. No, Pejar Swami gave an example. He said, what is the, he said, the Hindu youth is like a sand covered with a deep water reservoir. You know, you have to just scratch upper part few times and you'll find the spring of water coming out.
Amazing. Okay. No.
And now also, unfortunately, now also, when we present spirituality, we more impose compared to logically presenting it. Because imposition is very easy, but it is not sustainable.
Hmm.
Like Duryodhan's brothers were completely subservient to Duryodhan. It is a submission driven. It's authoritarian driven.
So then the ethos that in one sense, from my perspective, I should, like we say, they obey the spiritual master, obey the authority. That's more of a mood of respect that is to be cultivated. It's not.
You cannot create a system out of it. When you create a management system based upon this very deep foundational principle, it is destructive and it destroys people's sensitive area.
Sensitive area means in what sense?
Sensitive area means their heart, their consciousness, you know, their mind. These are all very sensitive places. When you impose so much, then there is at some point of time, you know, they rebel. To such an extent, they lose gratitude, they lose acknowledgement of what has been contributed in their life because they want to rebel against the authoritarian structure. Let submission be the consequences of logic and reason rather than submission giving rise to wrong kind of logic and reason.
That's so in one sense, we can say that the Bhagavad Gita is actually demonstrating this. Like, yeah. Although Krishna is God, Krishna is not imposing on Arjuna.
Yeah.
That Krishna is, even throughout, he is actually, there is a discussion where there's reasoning. And even when Krishna talks about his divinity, that he's not talking about his divinity to sort of extract obedience.
Yeah.
He's talking about his divinity to explain the worldview in which, by which Arjuna will naturally be able to choose what he should be doing.
Yeah. Even during that, and how do you know that Krishna was not extracting obedience? Because even during the battle of Kurukshetra, after hearing Bhagavad Gita from Krishna, at one point of time when Yudhishthira Maharaj spoke that lie and Dronacharya was killed, and then Ashwatthama had an outburst. And Arjuna had an outburst also against Yudhishthira Maharaj. And part of that outburst is questioning Lord Ramachandra killing Vali from behind.
Oh, okay.
Arjuna says that. And Krishna did not stand and blast Arjuna. He said, what the hell are you talking, man? You are questioning me?
Beautiful. Okay. So this is on the 17th day when Karna defeats Yudhishthir.
that is no no that on the day of Ashwatthama he raises the Narayanastra, na? He's about to strike with Narayanastra.
Okay, so at that time Arjuna
had a special affection for Dronacharya. He did not agree for Yudhishthira Maharaj to lie. When the lie happened, then Dronacharya was killed. So then there is an outburst of Arjuna against Yudhishthira Maharaj, saying that how could you do this? For the sake of kingdom, you killed your own guru. You killed a brahmana. You killed an elderly person. So Bhima became very angry. Then Arjuna brings it, you know, it is just like how Lord Ramchandra killed Wali from behind.
Okay.
Arjuna uses that example.
So interesting. So he is not directly criticizing Krishna, but he is actually using an example which is critical of Krishna.
Yeah. Okay. But that does not bother Krishna. He doesn't call it as a slander. It doesn't call it as Vaishnava aparad. He doesn't call it as Vigra aparad. He doesn't call it as Bhagavad aparad. You know, he just takes it, understanding the spirit of Arjuna, the pain of Arjuna, the attachment of Arjuna, the Lord doesn't take it much seriously. But unfortunately nowadays, when a subordinate is little not submissive, many leaders become very disturbed and they give big gan to them. You know, how could you do this? Why can't you take it in a sportive spirit? No.
That is true. So the point you are making through this is that Krishna is not imposing his authority all the time. And that was a part of a bigger point, that there is not, rather than controlling people, education is meant to empower people so that they can become thoughtful and they can take responsible decisions.
Yeah, and therefore, again, the Shastras talk, Mata Pratamo Guru, Pita Dvitiyo Guru, Acharya Tritiyo Guru. So without Mata Pita taking any role of just being a biological parents, hoping for their social, you know, growth, financial growth, and hoping that somebody else take responsibility of their spiritual growth. And then we say, you know, Guru is everything, he is Mata, he is Pita. Poetically, it is correct. But if the parents have not taken the responsibility, you are burdening a spiritual teacher to do more than what he can handle.
That's so true. And it's not only burdening the spiritual teacher, but also we set ourselves up for disappointment when that doesn't work out.
Yeah. And how will it will work? Because it is anti-Vedic principle. It's anti-human existence. It is anti, you know, reality of life. Because nobody can care for you all the time as much as your parents can care for you. And it is not the duty of guru to become father and mother. You can say you are like my father and mother, but you should understand that he is not your father and mother. It doesn't have the responsibility for fulfilling your emotional needs. It doesn't have the responsibility for fulfilling your social needs. You should know that he doesn't have the responsibility for giving you justice also. Guru is not a giver of justice. Guru is giver of knowledge of life, of your spiritual connection, and go and find where you get that justice.
So now, you know, some many of the things which you're mentioning can seem quite different from, say, what Prabhupada wrote in his books, or what Prabhupada, or the way Krishna consciousness is understood within ISKCON. Could it be because Prabhupada was actually introducing a spiritual culture in a very different world, and he circumstantially had to play all those roles? He initially arranged for the marriage of his disciples, and then he afterwards said, this is not the business of sannyasi, I'll not be doing it. So it's like what he was doing was more like apadharma at that time.
Yes, it is. He did not create a system based on that. What is the proof? Because when people try to imitate him, there was a huge disastrous effect.
Yeah.
You know. Therefore, again, again, when we study what Srila Prabhupada wanted to do, you have to reconnect with the Shastras also, na? When we reconcile between what is said, what we connected to Shastra, we'll see there is complete harmony. We'll understand the circumstantial instructions, constitutional instruction, and conditional instruction. When the conditional instruction and circumstantial instruction were brought into the public space in the form of bringing all the books in the public space, like the letters and everything, you know, then you take one letter suits you, thinking that this is also connected to me.
Okay.
The so, private letters are private letters. No. They should be kept in archives. And only when people, when you go to a museum, right? When you go to a museum, you get to read few letters. You know, somebody joins, not young person one who joins, he has accessibility to everything. It is like in our Kannada, there is a saying, Mangana Kayali Manikya. Manikya, it is a rare pearl only, but kiske atme, bandar ke atme ho. It is in the hand of monkey. It will not benefit.
So here you're comparing what with the monkey having a...
The monkey is a Kanishta one who has come to spirituality, and the Manikya is Prabhupada's writing, everything.
Oh, okay.
Bandar ke atme dega to problem hi hoga.
Yeah, and one of the challenges is that when we initially get the philosophy, hear the philosophy, somehow there is that phase that, oh, now I know the ultimate reality. And we, maybe this is actually a cross-cultural phenomena. In Christianity, they have what is called a zeal of the new convert.
Yeah.
Where so it is cross-cultural, but also it leads to a certain level of dismissiveness about other things in life, everything else.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've seen, broadly speaking, two conceptions of coming to Krishna consciousness. Like one is your whole pre-Krishna conscious life was like just a dream, whether it's a good dream or a bad dream. Just wake up and now your real life is beginning. And the other is that, you know, our Krishna conscious life is not basically like a rejection of our past, but it is like a building up on our past.
Yeah.
Some aspects of our past were good, on which we build upon, and some of aspects of our past are not so good, and then we have to deal with them.
Yes, very good.
So now, in particular situations, say quite often the way discussing, like you talked about the first guru, second guru, quite often when we practice Krishna consciousness, like you said earlier, that there is more focus on teaching rituals among the parents toward the children, rather than the teaching the rationale or the values or the ultimate purpose of life. So to some extent, there is an opposition towards serious spirituality. So what happens when the Pratham and Dvitiya Guru and the Tritiya Guru are in opposition? So what does one do at that time? Because that is a situation where many, at least in the early years of Krishna consciousness, they find themselves.
Yeah, so therefore no parents, there would be a people, see, somebody like, I come from a meat-eating background. Not because of modernity, because of cultural reality. Right? The environmental reality, since ages, right? But even that was given with a lot of affection and love. So what happened? The motherhood was experienced properly. The affectionate side was experienced. But when you come to spirituality, when you realize you are not supposed to eat meat, what happens? We condemn the meat along with the kindness given by the parents. Why can't separate?
So true.
No. Yeah. You don't have to continue eating meat, but don't condemn the kindness what they offered. Rejecting everything. And when that is facilitated by the people who are in the role of leadership, you know, what mother are you talking about? What father you are talking about? Your guru is everything. Then those kind of teaching
created.
You know, unfortunately, in many places, gurus disappeared. The parents are still there.
Oh God, yeah. That's true. So overall, what if I understand the direction which you are taking is that any growth in dharma, even if we are rising to our higher level of dharma, higher understanding of dharma, that should not be at the level of disrupting the preceding levels of dharma.
Yeah, it is like step. You cannot write any thesis without rejecting that will always remain in the background. When you write your book, why you're able to write a book? Because you, where somebody taught you in the first standard A, B, C, D. Did the A, B, C, D has been cancelled writing thesis? It is not consciously in the forefront, but without A, B, C, D, you cannot read thesis only. You don't read A, I, E, E. You read sentence. You don't read sentence. You read para. You don't read para. You read pages. You don't read pages. You read book. And you don't read book. You read concepts. You grasp the concept. But where does it come from? It comes from every word the author wrote. Every drop of water makes into ocean. We want an ocean without a drop. That is the modern civilization. That is the modern spiritual culture.
Oh, okay. That's nicely put. So it's almost like, rather than considering that the drops build up to make the ocean, what we are saying is that there is no need for the drops at all. We'll just have the ocean.
Yeah. But that is not possible. I don't need alphabet. I don't need letter. I need just PhD. Are, how will you read it? When you said Gita is the ABCD or Gita is the basic and Bhagavatam is the highest, the foundation of basic is not there. What will you understand a PhD? You'll misunderstand. The basic will not be rejected. The basic remains the foundation forever and always. The whole idea of modern civilization, accept this, cancel this. Accept this, cancel this. Use and throw. But the Vedic lifestyle or the Dharmic lifestyle is everything has its role in harmonious and organic growth of people, including a kindergarten teacher, even ABCD teacher who taught you ABCD and one was teaching a huge deeper thesis in life. In those times, they're valuable, their contribution is foundational, and therefore Mata Pratama Guru, Pita Dvitiya Guru, and Acharya Tritiya Guru. If Prahlad can never reject his father, can anybody be greater than Prahlad Maharaj in regards to devotion? Even if I consider that, you know, I am like Prahlad Das and my bap is Hiranyakashipu boss, still you don't have the right to slander, because Prahlad did not do that. Neither Lord Narsingdev. Lord Narsingdev simply gave a surgery to Hiranyakashipu without destroying his identity.
You know, only recently it struck me that when Prahlad is using the word like Asurvarya Dehina, that is not an insult. Asurvarya, you are the greatest of the Asuras. In his context, it's actually he's respecting Hiranyakashipu.
Because Asur ka cool hai na, it's a cooler.
You are the greatest.
Yeah, you are the greatest among the Prajapatis. You know, if you are greatest among the Kashyapa Gotra, so like that, you are greatest among the Patil, you are greatest among the Patel.
Okay.
You can't tell it to the Kulkarni community, hey, you are greatest among the Patel. Are you Kulkarni?
Okay. Yeah, and in that sense, even see how Krishna also, in the Bhagavad Gita, he's talking about the Vibhutis. He says, Daityanam aham Prahlada, he says. Prahlada chasmi Daityanam. So just because Prahlada is a devotee, he doesn't deny the fact that he is.
And therefore, in the Ramayana, when Hanumanji was not willing to find any faults with Vibhishan, and Sugriv was trying to find every fault in Vibhishan. So ultimately, Ram Chandra himself solved this problem. he told both of them, you look, you are seeing only fault, and Hanuman, you are not seeing any fault. He said, I am saying there is a fault in him, and that it doesn't matter to me. That is the brother of Ravan. Wo hamesha ke liye rahega, wo kabhi nahi khatam hoga. His identity being a brother of Ravan will not go away. But that does not stop him from being our friend and our brother also. Therefore, when Lord Ram came to Ayodhya, he introduced Vibhishan as one of his brother.
Oh.
But not cancelling his relationship with Ravan.
Okay.
This is called as an integration. No cancellation.
It's beautiful. So at one earlier we were talking at a spiritual level also, like Pandita Samadarshina. At the same time, there is equality of vision, while there is, you could say, variety in how we interact in interaction.
Yeah.
So similarly, with respect to one other aspects of one's identity, not just one's spiritual identity, like one's genealogical identity or birth identity, there is acknowledgement of that, but there is no reduction of the person to that.
Yeah.
Because you are born in this family, therefore you must be like this. You will be like this.
That's a very, and therefore when we have such a profound reality of dharma, and therefore dharma never ceased to exist. The rishis were alert but never panicky. They were not reactive in regards to protecting dharma, but they would go back to the foundational principle only.
It's beautiful.
You know, they did play the apadharma. Apadharma is there. You know, if there is a need, everyone can raise weapons. But let those who are supposed to raise the weapons, nobody should discourage them from raising the weapons. In the name of non-violent philosophy.
So you could say at one level, dharma in one sense is recognizing a person's individuality while also respecting the fact that they belong to a whole.
Yes.
So there are people who will be raising weapons, and there will be people who will not raise weapons, and both have a place.
Both have a place. Therefore, Dalai Lama practiced non-violent philosophy, but not necessarily is a vegetarian.
Yeah.
You know, Lord Krishna is a pure vegetarian, but not necessarily non-violent. and in fact, Krishna integrated for dharma, there is no conflict between non-violence and violence. For dharma, there is no conflict between so-called untruth and truth. For dharma, there is no conflict between simple and smart. For dharma, there is no conflict between a politician and a rishi. Dharma has the power to integrate between the politician and a rishi and call him as a rajarshi.
Integrate. Okay, but then in one sense, the varanas are different, isn't it?
The purpose ultimately for any varna you are, you know, you should have the disposition of rishi even though you are a carpenter. Brahmanatva is the reality for everybody. It is not copyright of some people. Brahmanatva mera bhi adhikar hai, ek juta silane wale ka bhi adhikar hai. एक साधारण व्यक्ति जो झाड़ू लगाते हैं उसका भी अधिकार है. बिकॉज ब्राह्मणत्व इज बियॉन्ड, इट इज फ्री टू एवरीबडी. देयरफॉर अ राजा कैन ऑल्सो बिकम अ ऋषि, अ कारपेंटर ऑल्सो कैन बी अ ऋषि. ही मे नॉट क्लेम दैट इज अ ऋषि, यू नो. राजा विल नॉट टेक द रोल ऑफ वशिष्ठ, ही विल कंटिन्यू टू रिमेन राजा. But he has the disposition of rishitva. He will not change his profession. Kal se carpenter bolega, mujhe bhi puja karna hai, main bhi shaadi lagata hu, main bhi ye karta hu. Then what happens? It creates a disruption of profession, unnecessary competition. you do the same thing. Your carpentry work also has a contribution in puja. Aap wo spoon banate ho yajna ke liye. वो मिस्त्री होता है वो यज्ञ का ब्रिक बनाता है. When people say that temple were controlled by the brahmanas, अरे temple requires how many communities to contribute? The brahmana may be in the forefront in the altar, but the deity which has been carved, it is done by the sculptor. He from the jati perspective, he falls into the category of shudra. जो शूद्र ने बनाया हुआ creation को, उस मूर्ति को हम भगवान के रूप में देखते हैं. अगर वो नहीं है तो कहां से मूर्ति आ गई? So where is the question of one community is controlling over others? A temple is nothing but a control by the brahmanas. Yes, there were some wrong people, but doesn't mean that the community itself is wrong. Right. So therefore, the whole principle, you know, how dharma protection, nobody can claim that one Bahubali will come, one Virat Kohli will come, just like in the cricket or just like in the movie industry. And I'll be a spectator all the time to celebrate the victory of an individual. Even the Avatara Tattva does not do that. Avatara Tattva is one of the greatest contribution is to facilitate everyone to become a kind of a small dharma establisher. The spirit of Avatara Tattva, Ishwar ka amsh, everybody has that Ishwar amsha. So what is Avatara? Rekindling the lost valor in every living entity. And he makes everybody a warrior according to their propensity. And there are hardly somebody to clap in the stadium, because the war of life does not happen in the stadium. It happens in the real ground where everybody is a participant. In whichever community, whichever country, whichever civilization, more number of people are clapping and only one is performing, that is doomsday, that will cease to exist. Therefore, dharma is backtrack. How can, like I say, one young lady, she does Bhagavad Katha. Now, from a tribal community, I met her recently. In her talk, she was explaining. And simply by her Bhagavad Katha, she does in the tribal areas. Recently, she brought back, not by propaganda, not by temptation, simply by giving knowledge to them. Birsa Munda, you must have heard his name. He was a tribal leader. Just to get into education, he was converted to Christianity. And then he realized the atrocity of East India Company and British. He stood against them. And to stand against them, this very person became a Vaishnav, if you study carefully. He started giving them Tulsi tree along with some Harinam. And along with Vaishnavism, he also created a revolution against the British, and he was hanged at the age of 23. Right.
No, and sorry, but I didn't know about his becoming a Vaishnava specifically.
Yeah, he became Vaishnava. That is not spoken by the left liberals about his conversion to Vaishnavism.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So therefore, the whole point what we were discussing, you know, if every family, you know, Sanatan Dharma will never be protected by one person. One person may take a lead, like Shivaji Maharaj took the lead, but he never showed a superhuman power in regards to I will fight thousands of people. No, he never played all those emotional stuff. He created the spirit of everybody to become so good and fight against the invaders. So in from that perspective, you know, when the Mughals saw Shivaji everywhere, when Tukaram Maharaj is performing Kirtan, I would say for that story, the spirit of Shivaji was there in everybody. When the Shivaji spirit was there, everybody, the Mughals did not dare to attack.
Oh, so it could be at one level seen as a mystical vision, but at another level, it was also like a practical reality also that.
Yeah. You know? So therefore, this is the core of Avatara Tattva. Avatara Tattva comes to inspire everybody to contribute something, except Rukmi and who Balramji, they did not take part.
Okay.
Everybody else was there to take part. People were cooking, people were cleansing, people were nursing, people were washing clothes. All community took part in the battle of Kurukshetra, not necessarily fighting, but providing resources to many people. Har ek vyakti, you know, was a participant in some of the battle. While they're fighting, they're looking, wow, God, what, how Arjuna is fighting. They were simultaneously a participant and also spectator in special battles. But not only pure spectators eating their, when the people go to watch movies, popcorn.
Okay.
The popcorn spectators, they've already destroyed their dharma. And even Avatara will not be able to protect them. Only the time. When they again decide, no, I need to change. The Kaal hi unko buddhi dega. Or jab Kaal unko buddhi dega, they will throw their popcorn and take their particular sword against Adharma and beginning with oneself. Therefore, you know, the conviction of the rishis is that dharma can never be destroyed. You know, recently somebody told me very interesting one, very senior person, a lady who is into investing her money in stock market since 1970s. A lady. So she was telling me, Prabhuji, kai company ke, some of the stock of certain companies, they are like elephant. They will never become ass or dog. Bhav kam ho sakta hai. Rate may come down, but they continue to remain an elephant.
Okay.
Like Prabhupada said, elephant dead or alive is still valuable.
Okay. In fact, Prabhupada used that to refer to actually even into India itself.
The civilization, yes.
The civilization, okay.
Yeah.
So overall, if you see, if the way you have been discussing is that rather than becoming panicky or becoming hopeless, the whole point has been like take individual responsibility.
Yeah.
And you're talking about Avatar. I was also thinking at that time that Krishna did fight and kill some demons himself, but then Krishna had Arjuna. And the whole Bhagavad Gita was spoken not so that Krishna will do, it's spoken so that Arjuna will learn to do his duty. It is more for the human to participate or cooperate with the divine.
Yes. No, no war. Even Krishna killed demons in Vrindavan. You know, like seen Govardhan Lila, at least everybody is putting their stick. And even from the rasa perspective, one of the boys telling Krishna, hey Krishna, you must be tired. You know, give the Govardhan to Shridama's hand. And if you think he can't lift, at least change your hand so that we can massage your hand. So even in that level, there is a need to assist and cooperate. While enjoying Krishna's great power, the gopas are thinking, you know, we also have to contribute in lifting the Govardhan hill.
And their contribution is in terms of doing whatever is...
whatever they could do. To the extent where they're offering Krishna, if you believe that he can't lift, then at least change your hand. We know that we can lift. Siridhama defeats you in the wrestling match. So he can, if he can lift Govardhan Hill and Siddhama defeats you in the wrestling match, he can also lift. But if you don't have trust in Siddhama, at least change your hand. We can massage your hand.
Oh God. Beautiful.
So whether it is Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu or whether it is Mahabharata, the principle of contribution in the cause of Dharma will always exist for everybody. Okay. Depending upon who you are, what you are. If you don't, then you become cause of adharma. When there is a large number of people who do not know, then it becomes a colossal adharma.
So even if we have one powerful person comes and does something, it will not lead to much transformation. Rather, so maybe there's one last point I'd like to discuss. And of course, there's many more points which we could discuss. But why is it that if the ethos is on individual responsibility, there is so much of a personality cult kind of formation within the dharmic traditions? I mean, if we consider objectively speaking, in today's world, there are Christians who have mega churches with these big pastors. But even there, it is because Jesus is the central person, that there is not so much centered worshipping of that particular pastor. But in our tradition, it's not just within Vaishnavism, but in general, there seems to be a lot of personality cult that is there. So the guru-centered ideas. So where has this come from actually?
That is the question which we can discuss more deeper. But the point is, yes, it is there. And therefore, if you study carefully, whether it is Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, when they wrote, or in the previous, like in the Vedic tradition, or even Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami himself explained that Guru, Ishta Mantra, and Ishta Dev are always a private affair.
Yeah.
Become very, very strongly prominent, and it becomes cause of redundancy.
Oh. Okay.
No, it causes violence, it causes radicalization, it causes small-mindedness. That people judge you based upon your relationship with your guru rather than judging your character and what you can contribute. And in this way, there is a huge lack of, resources are disturbed, unused. Doesn't matter whom you belong to, as long as you are resourceful of that guru, so don't imagine. So because of your identity with particular personality, your contribution is not used. The huge human resources wasted. Mm-hmm. A limitless potential is used, wasted in regards to contributing to the cause of growth of society. Now, in the villages, now we see that in the villages, I was in the recent village. Previously, the contribution to the village was based upon the village people from that village only. Now, if you're doing something good to the village and you happen to be connected to remotely also one political party, the other political party will see that you don't become successful because they fear that the party will get the credit.
Yes.
So what happens in this way, both political parties in the village are fighting each other against the very development of the village. Village is like that father, and the political parties are like two brothers. When they fight with each other, they're basically causing a great damage to the very village. And this is unfortunately in so many villages.
That is true. Actually, even at
and when you do it on a state level, you don't see the impact. But when you go to the village level, you see the impact, how drastically that impacts the village's growth.
It's growing or not growing, basically, or how it is being impeded. Yeah.
Yeah. Very clearly you can see that visible result.
So this you are connecting with what that this narrow-mindedness comes because
narrow-mindedness comes that because if you have the capacity to contribute, but I will judge you based upon whom, which party do you belong to?
Oh, okay.
You belong to ISKCON party, you belong to Ramakrishna Mission party, you belong to Sadhguru party, you belong to Ravi Shankar party. You know, and because you don't belong to the party which I belong, I will not facilitate your contribution. And within the organization also it happens. Do you belong to this guru, that guru? Do you belong to this counselor, that counselor? You know.
Yeah.
And then the human potential of contribution is so damaged. On a consciousness level, it affects us. On the social level, it affects us. On a political front also, it is very disruptive. Therefore, our rishis are so deep in their idea and in thought process. He says, you worship Guru because you want to respect and experience the Guru Tattva. You respect your Rashtra so that you can transcend Rashtriyata and focus on Dharma.
Oh.
A Rashtriyata without Dharma will become nationalism of the European world.
You know, this is something which will really require unpacking. Maybe we'll have another session on this, but this is beautiful. So,
in one sense, identifying with one's nation is not a bad thing. But if that identification is without some fundamental values,
then it is dangerous.
Yes.
And therefore, dharmic nation like Bharat had no problem. We didn't need a constitution to live a harmonious life. Like Sai Deepak had written a book, you know, and he was debating with Shashi Tharoor. Everybody should see that debate. You know, he's saying you don't teach us secularism through constitution to tell that we need to treat everybody with respect. He said our civilization has done repeatedly again and again. Without this constitution also, accepted the Parsis, accepted the Islam, accepted Christianity, accepted, you know, a springing of other faith within the Hindu community, Sikh, the Jainism, Buddhism, right? You know, so he said, and therefore, the European nationhood was based upon nation alone. Even faith did not unite Europe. No, the nation destroyed the faith because German, French, or British, they're all Christians only. But that did not unite them. Nation divided them. But Dharma has the power to transcend the Rashtra without dismantling the Rashtra. And therefore, for Atithi Satkar, you should have the power if that Atithi turns into an invader.
That's true. So Dharma is not frozen. Dharma is dynamic.
Very dynamic.
It's on, okay, makes sense. So
we'll stop here.
Sorry?
We'll stop here.
Yes, definitely, bro. This you could say there's so much more to discuss, but I'll quickly try to summarize. We broadly discussed today about when we want to, we discussed primarily from the historical, educational and political perspectives about Dharma. So historically, protection of Dharma didn't necessarily mean it was, Dharma was resilient within the Indian tradition because Dharma is not seen as something external. It is basically understanding our nature and aligning with our nature. And even if external structures were disrupted or destroyed, but the internal spirit of people living according to their particular nature was always there. And that's how later on you mentioned how Shivaji Maharaj, he created many, many Shivaji people with the spirit of Shivaji Maharaj. And like that, across the, from that hill tribe, across my in whole of India, there were people who were inspired to protect Dharma. So then we discussed over there about from just as historically, while there are remnants of dharmic principles in various traditions across the world also, But still, what has happened is when you talk about samskaras, they are not necessarily just specific rituals. Yeah, they are refined understandings of how, or refined expressions of how the innate nature could be brought about. But at some level, understanding that we all have to harmonize, and some practices by which we can harmonize with ourselves, that was there everywhere. And the Vedic tradition was such that if dharma could even critique faith or shraddha, if that shraddha was disharmonious. So in that sense, fanaticism comes when one's faith makes one do things which are against one's own conscience also. And then people often become externally aggressive because they are internally insecure or internally empty. So then later we discussed about in the educational ethos, it is not just Brahmanas who taught everything. Rather, their Brahminical vritti was there, which was there in every Varna, and then there were teachers accordingly. So education was never controlled by the state, and not even in consensus controlled by the Brahmanas. The idea is that it was broadly provided. It was according to the needs of people, it was provided for at various places. And then even if we talk about the guru's role, the spiritual master's role was more of, was not that the spiritual master replaces the parents. There is a third guru. And every teacher plays their own role. And recognizing that our spiritual growth is not rejecting the past, but it's building on the good from the past. So we understand that that's more of, that won't be disruptive. Otherwise, things become disruptive. The whole idea is that even a teacher's success is that to not make the student dependent, but to actually make the student eager to learn and then able to think and make decisions according oneself. And even Krishna himself demonstrates that in the Bhagavad Gita, when he doesn't impose on Arjuna using his godhood, but he asks Arjuna to think and decide. And he also mentioned how even when Arjuna criticizes Yudhishthir for having gone along with the plot that killed Drona, and he mentions about he objects to the way Ram acted. Krishna doesn't take objection to that in the killing of Vali when Ram acted. So the idea is that that was one thing which you didn't explore, but I think you pointed out that there's the constitutional, circumstantial, and conditional. And so instructions can be at different levels. And if you take one instruction and absolutize it, it's like, what was the metaphor? A jewel in the hands of a
monkey. Yeah.
Monkey. Yeah. It will just cause damage. It will not be valued. So like that, we can take valid and valuable instructions, but we can misunderstand it. That's why even the words of the guru have to be seen in the context of the words of Shastra and the broader tradition through which things have emerged. And toward the end, we discussed also about how in today's world, when there is, if you consider this was like a theme which is going on throughout, that yes, there may be things in the way dharma is implemented in which they need to be, things need to be reformed. But rather than focusing on that reformation, many people say that dharma itself is to be condemned. And that is where problem comes up. So the focus needs to be on that. Yes, there are different ways in which it may be attacked, the social dimension, in the political dimension, in media it may be misrepresented. But if we can ourselves understand and then we explain the subtlety, the profundity of how somebody like exalted like Bhishma could be attacked for being on the side of Adharma, but still at the same time could be respected. So that this kind of subtlety in understanding and interacting these principles, if we explain them systematically, then that itself will attract thoughtful people. And rather than trying to create a system which will force people to adhere to certain things, we focus on sharing the wisdom, and then that itself will gradually lead to the transformation of society. And rather than waiting for some special person to come. Even when the avatar comes, the avatar doesn't actually do everything, but rather avatar creates the spirit within everyone to reform. So overall, the protection, the onus, if you want to protect dharma, it is more that we take responsibility to know who we are and contribute. And then we play our various roles in society responsibly with spiritual guidance and or rather keeping the spiritual purpose in mind. And then that's how Dharma could be protected and rejuvenated. Oh. Anything you'd like to add, Prabhu?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. This is a wonderful discussion. Hare Krishna. Mm-hmm.